As Busby and Shankly were developing their careers as players in England, Jock Stein, 9 years younger than Shankly, was progressing through school and into his long period as a working miner.
What did you want to become, quite apart from football?
Well, I was a son of a miner. There wasn't much you wanted to be other than a miner, and it turned out that way, and my ambitions weren't very high at that particular time.
I'm not going to say I remember the worst period of it, but I do remember when it was really tough.
Yes.
And if there were two slices of bread in the house, I was lucky I got it, sort of style. But tough, and people
depend. That was when being the youngest helped you.
That's helped me greatly. But the thing about it was that happened in families, and it happened between families and that. You know, right. And in the mining community, and many of these mining communities were closely knit. And there used to be a saying, you know, you could walk down the miner's rows and you could throw a stain. You'd hit a relative, but not necessarily a friend of mine. But, and they grew up in this sort of atmosphere of community, understanding.
There's also, it would seem, less of a tendency for miners to forget where they came from than may be the case even with other groups of working class people.
Oh, miners always remember where they came from, aye.
You were telling me a story earlier, Harry, about Jock organising a special lift for himself.
Tell
me what happened there.
It was actually, we all worked in the castle. It's only 5 minutes in the train from Bothwell to Burnbank. Well, we all used to need to go off at Burnbank station. But Jock had a concession with the train driver. He got off the train at Yernick Ross.
Well, the train driver just stopped
him. Stopped him and let Joke off. And he went away and got his dinner. And we had all to walk maybe a quarter mile up to the house, and Joke got dropped off at the house with the train. Because the train went by his back door.
And his mother was waiting there
with
the soup.
Aye. His soup was on the table and Big Joke and his dinner.
They tell me he could shift a fair amount of...
A bine of soup he'd eat.
Harry said a bine.
Aye, it was a bine.
A ladle fee, wasn't he? What's good to him?
We could eat. That was one thing about him.
I remember I was sitting at home with Bob and the lot of them playing at Pontoon, and one of my sisters came along and she said, there's a wire for you from Carlisle. You've got to go down tomorrow and meet them.
I don't suppose you've lost one nuance of Scottishness. You're in fact perhaps more Scottish than when you left Scotland.
Oh yes, if Scotland went to war tomorrow, I would be the first one to volunteer.
I mean, in the dressing rooms, there's often a lot of ribbing. If Scotland get beaten, the English players, you know, get at the Scottish. But do you find that?
Oh, I can clamp them down. I can look after myself and them as well. When I hear any sarcasm being thrown about, I can be as sarcastic as anybody else. So that doesn't worry me. But people who do live away from Scotland, I think, feel more Scottish than the people that live in Scotland.
Bill Shankly's move to England from Glenbuck came 4 years after Matt Busby had left Lanarkshire, a gap that corresponded exactly with the difference in their ages. All five of the Shankly brothers became professional footballers, but Bill and Bob were the most famous.
I was working in the pits, so was Bob, of course. Then I played for a team called Cranberry. That's near Cumnock in Ayrshire. And from there I went to Carlisle on a month's trial, and they signed me on.
Now, it's a very unglamorous start for what has been a glamorous career in football. Carlisle United.
Yeah.
What was it like in those days?
I thought it was grim, really, looking back. Shoddy training kit. Old pros that had been with all the big teams in England, you know, on their closing days. Fly men. First Sunday I was there, I had a game of brag with them and got skinned. Sunday night came along, I didn't have a penny in my pocket. I thought it was pretty grim. But that didn't deter me. I mean, I was only in for... That was only a stepping stone.
So Matt Busby and Bill Shankly both had the bulk of their careers as players and managers in England. Did people in Scotland still identify with them very strongly, in spite of that distance?
Oh, I think hugely, yeah. I mean, I think, first of all, I think it's a very Scottish thing, really, too. Although there's a Scottish thing which keeps saying, don't get above yourself, I think there's also a great capacity for admiring excellence as you would get anywhere else. And I think they just loved the achievement of them. I think they especially loved it because they did it in England. Because, I mean, I think as you've said before, it was it was a means of saying almost that, see, we have to get down and really, really show them how to do it. And I've often thought it's like, I mean, as you know, the Scots have exported whatever talents they have all the time anyway. And I sometimes see managers, Scottish managers in England, like a kind of variant of the Scottish engineers. Used to find them everywhere all over the world, because they knew how things work, you know. And I think these managers knew how things work partly because, and this is not to insult the undoubted talent at football they did have, but partly perhaps because they were not of the very highest rank. And those who, like Big Jock, who would have said himself, who was a reasonably modest player, those who are like that, I think, have to work the game out very carefully. If you're George Best, you probably don't notice what the game's about because you're a genius, you just do it anyway. But I think these men all had to very carefully, you know, work out the mechanics of what the game was.
Matt Busby came from Motherwell, was intended to be a schoolmaster, but now gives the cane to the opposing forward.
It was the opportunity to show his quality in the influential midfield position of right half that enabled Busby to establish himself in the Manchester City first team. They were beaten in the FA Cup final of 1933, but went all the way to Wembley again in 1934.
The winning goal. Look at that Portsmouth player taking the ball out of the net. Hasn't his back got a sweet expression?
Over a million people greeted the team, and of course, couldn't know. Many had walked for miles just to see what all this Wembley business really did mean, and they found out. Yes, what Lancashire doesn't know about cup football isn't worth knowing. Bowen and his boys have just proved it.
After City's homecoming as FA Cup winners, Busby was never again going to feel like an outsider in Manchester. Celebration had not made his smoking style any more extravagant.
Now I knew full well that it was only a matter of time to get into Preston's team, and when I got in, I said to the bloke, I said, that's you finished. You get no more games.
Further north in Lancashire, at Preston, Shankly was emerging as another example of how Scottish footballers of that era had a habit of making themselves vital influences at the heart of leading English teams.
I think his main asset was the fact he was so confident. Before the game, irrespective of who he was playing against, some of the lads would be pulling his leg prior to the game starting and say, you know, you'll have a rough time today, but there's some players. He said, he's no better than me until he shows me. And he used to go out and play like that.
Being one of the greatest of footballers, a master predator on either wing or at centre-forward, did not discourage Tom Finney from qualifying as a tradesman and building up his own business. And to the sports pages, he was the Preston plumber. To Shankly, he was always Tommy Finney, the genius against whom every other player had to be measured.
What was your first impression of Shankly when you encountered him here?
Well, my first impressions was, Bill, when I was a junior here and joined Preston North End as a junior in 37. And Bill always had a habit, even though he's an established first-team player then, of coming along and watch the junior side of Preston North End play. And it always took a great interest in that, and I never forgot that, because he always came across and had a word with you, and as far as we were concerned, that was really utopia.
In 1938, Preston repeated Manchester City's pattern of a few seasons before by winning the cup final after losing in the previous year. Club success led to international caps for Busby and Shankly, but soon the Scotland teammates found their careers distorted and diminished by the Second World War. When the war brought inevitable suspension of the normal form of league football, the game continued with regional competitions in which clubs made unrestrained use of guest players from the armed forces. And as a further boost to morale, international and representative matches were fairly plentiful. Matt Busby was a Sergeant Major physical training instructor, but it was a different kind of authority that made him Scotland's captain in a wartime international at Wembley. He was given a small taste of his future in management when put in charge of a British Army team sent to Italy to entertain the troops behind the lines. Bill Shankly, as a corporal in the RAF, guested with clubs all over Britain, from Arbroath to Arsenal, and he played for Scotland in wartime internationals. As an extra outlet for the fitness that was an obsession with him, he also boxed. The younger Jock Stein, kept at home because mining was a reserved occupation, made a modest advance as a footballer by signing in 1942 as a part-time professional with Albion Rovers, a Lanarkshire club playing in the same wartime league as Celtic and Rangers.
I was at my peak, 24 when the war started. I was at my peak, and I think that everybody was in the same boat, of course. It took 6 years of our life away, really, as players.
Played a bit of school and amateur football when I left school, but and I was a main part-time player with Albion Rovers. It was only a way of extra money, and I was in the pits at the time, and the extra money was welcome, but players being transferred from Albion over that particular time, I was always one who was kept. Whether I wasn't good enough, or whether I was important enough, I think it would be possibly the first one there. I wasn't good enough, but I always felt that each year I was losing more and more interest in it and getting less keen each year.
The ground had been blitzed. They had an overdraft at the bank. What is more, I had very little experience. I had no experience as a manager. And I felt they were taking a great risk in appointing me. All I had, apart from playing experience, were certain ideas as to what the manager should do, faith in those ideas, and faith in the future of the club.
The need to rebuild that applied to everything and everybody at the end of the war presented itself in particularly stark terms at Manchester United. It was a daunting challenge that 36-year-old Matt Busby accepted in 1945 by signing a contract to manage United as soon as he was demobbed. How Busby responded changed the history of football.